Hello students, I welcome you all to my YouTube channel Ujjwal Biology Classes. Today I will begin you with a new chapter, that is human reproduction. This chapter, along with the second chapter reproductive health, carries around 18% weightage in terms of NEET and is also very vital for the class 12 board examinations. Let's begin. First of all, let us take a look at all the events which will be taking place in human reproduction. Previously, हम लोग ये भी देखे थे कि जो भी reproduction के अंदर stages होते थे, we divide it into specially three types. The pre-fertilization, fertilization and the post-fertilization events. The pre-fertilization events, that is formation of gametes and after that the transfer of the gametes. Here also, to begin with, we have the formation of gametes, that is also known as gametogenesis. It is a very important step in sexual reproduction. Gametogenesis is of two types, as we have two different sexes. In males, the process is known as spermatogenesis, and in females, it is oogenesis. The second step is the transfer of the male gametes, that is the sperms, into the female genital tract, and this is termed as insemination. The second step, which is a very important in sexual reproduction, that is the fertilization, which is fusion of the male and female gametes. Now coming up to the post-fertilization events. First of all, we have implantation, that is the formation and development of blastocyst. We will be coming up later ki what is blastocyst. So the zygote forms cleavage division and it forms a structure known as blastocyst, and then that blastocyst enters into the uterus and attaches itself to the wall of the uterus. So attachment of the blastocyst to the endometrium wall of the uterus is known as implantation. And with this, the beginning of the pregnancy happens, and now the zygote will be ultimately changing and developing into an embryo and later into the fetus. So we have a gestation period, or the process rather is known as gestation, which is also embryonic development phase. And finally, when the fetus is fully developed and it is ready to come out, the process or the delivery of the new baby is known as parturition. Let us take a look to our next slide, which is about the male reproductive system. So the following organs. Now, in the reproductive system of the male and female, we further classify it into the primary sex organs and the secondary sex organs. For the primary sex organ in males, we have a pair of testes which remains in the scrotum or the scrotal sacs. In the secondary or accessory sex organs, we have accessory ducts. In the accessory ducts, there is the retitestis, the vasa efferentia, we have epididymis, and finally the vas deferens. Through the vas deferens, it enters into the urethra and comes out through the body. In the accessory glands, we have seminal vesicle, we have the prostate, and we have the bulbourethral or the Cowper's gland. And finally, the external genitalia, we have the penis. Let us take a look into the picture. Now see, this is your testis. From the testis, it will be arising the epididymis, through which there will be the sperm duct or the vas deferens, which makes a loop over the urinary bladder and it enters and joins into the urethra. Here we have the seminal vesicle, which pours its secretions into the urethra. Then we have the prostate gland, and finally we have the bulbourethral gland or the Cowper's gland. In our next slides, we will be having a closer look into all the functions of this gland. So now, let us have a look into the primary sex organ of the males, that is the testes. We have a pair of testes which is enclosed inside a very thin wall of skin pouches that is called the scrotum or the scrotal sacs. So the testis is situated inside a pouch like structure which is also called the scrotal bags or the scrotum. In between the scrotal sacs, there is a cavity in which there is a tissue fluid called the hydrocele. What is the function of the scrotum? Now, scrotum acts as thermoregulators. That is, they control the temperature, which is very necessary for the process of spermatogenesis to occur. The scrotal sacs are situated rather outside the body, human body, inside the abdominal cavity, and this helps to lower down the body temperature around 2 to 2.5 degree centigrade. So the scrotal sacs has the advantage of their situation, of their location outside the body, and hence they have a temperature of 2 to 2.5 degree centigrade lower than the normal body temperature. That is very vital for the formation of sperms through spermatogenesis. Now, each testis is externally covered by a dense fibrous tissue that is also called the tunica albuginea. Let us look into the diagram first of all. So here we have the diagram of the testis, and the testis is situated in this purple colored or rather violet colored the scrotal sacs. The scrotal sacs has two layers. The outer one is the parietal and the inner one is the visceral layer. There lies a cavity in between the parietal and the visceral layer, and this cavity remains enclosed with the tissue fluid hydrocele. Moving into the testis. The testis remains inside a capsule which is also known as the tunica albuginea. And this tunica albuginea forms several septa dividing the testis into a number of testicular lobules. Inside a testis, there are around 250 such testicular lobules occur. And inside each testicular lobule, there is the seminiferous tubules. So, the scrotal sac and the testis layered by the tunica albuginea. So, here we have the tunica albuginea, which forms several septa dividing the testis into a number of lobules, around 250 in number. And each testicular lobule has 1 to 3 highly convoluted or folding structure with tube-like structure that is known as the seminiferous tubule. And finally, the seminiferous tubules opens into a large network of tubules which is called the retitestis. Moving back into the picture, we have this highly convoluted seminiferous tubule moving into the reticestes, the network of large tubules. So now moving into the next, that is having a closer look inside the seminiferous tubule. Each seminiferous tubule is now lined by specialized cells, and these specialized cells are also called the spermatogonia in plural and spermatogonium in singular. And this spermatogonium is also rather known as the male mother cell or the sperm mother cell. Along with the spermatogonia cells, inside the seminiferous tubules, there is also another cells which are known as the Sertoli cells, or specially known as nurse cells or subtentacular cells. So inside the seminiferous tubule, the lining, we have the spermatogonia with several Sertoli cells. Now we know that the spermatogonia is diploid in structure, that is having 2n set of chromosomes, that is total 23 pairs or 46 chromosomes. So these spermatogonia undergoes reduction division, that is it undergoes meiosis 1 and 2 to form the sperms. But this process of spermatogenesis is not so simple as it is looking over here in one line. There are several steps which we'll be moving into our later slides only on spermatogenesis. So let us have a quick look at what are the function of these cells. So we have got spermatogonium, they will be forming the sperms after undergoing meiosis. Second, we have the Sertoli cells, now nurse, so they provide a helping hand. To whom? To the developing sperms. So the function of the Sertoli cells is to provide nutrition to the developing sperms and making them active so that they can take part in the process of fertilization. Second, between the seminiferous tubules, we have an interstitial space, and that interstitial space contains certain endocrinal cells which are called the interstitial or the Leydig cell. Let us have a quick look in the picture. This is the structure of inside the seminiferous tubule. Let us have a look into the other picture first of all, and then we will be getting back into this. So this is your the testis. Inside the lobule we have the coiled seminiferous tubule. Now this tube like structure, we have cut it into two, and a transverse section is over here. So see, it is like a transverse section of a pipe or a tube like structure, which have, this is the outer lining, which represents the outer lining of the seminiferous tubule. The outer lining is lined by the germinal cell or the sperm mother cell or the spermatogonia cells. And in between, we have some nurse cells or the Sertoli cells. Now this spermatogonia forms the sperms, and then the sperms move towards the Sertoli cell to provide nutrition, to take nutrition from them. Now, this is all happening inside the seminiferous tubule. Now what about the outer side of the seminiferous tubule? Let us now have a look into this part. Here we have a seminiferous tubule, and like this we have, suppose we have a seminiferous tubule of over here also. So the space between the two seminiferous tubule, that is this space which is along over here, is known as the interstitial space. And inside the interstitial space, we have certain kind of cells which are known as the interstitial cells. Now what are the function of these cells? Let us have a look. So inside the seminiferous tubule, we have the spermatogonia, we have the interstitial cells, we have the Sertoli cells. Sertoli cells are the nurse cells providing nutrition to the developing sperms, spermatogonia forming the sperms, and now the interstitial cells or the Leydig cells has a very vital role, that is they synthesize the sex hormone, the male sex hormone, that is the testosterone. So these interstitial cells having endocrinal facility in them. So the Leydig cells synthesize and secrete testosterone, which not only controls the development of the secondary sexual characters, but also they take participate in the process of spermatogenesis. So, in sum up of this slide, spermatogonia forming sperms, Sertoli cells providing nutrition to the developing sperms, and in between the seminiferous tubule, in the interstitial space, we have the Leydig cells which secrete testosterone that controls the secondary sexual characters during puberty, and they help in the process of spermatogenesis. So students, now we have discussed about the testis, we have discussed about the seminiferous tubule, and now we will be moving into the accessory duct system of the male. In the previous slides, we have learned that what is the duct system, what is the accessory or the secondary sex duct system. It consists of the vasa efferentia, it has the retitestis, the epididymis, and the vas deferens. So, first of all, let us have a quick look into the picture. So, this is your seminiferous tubule moving into a highly network of the retitestis. Retitestis moves into the efferent ductules, or these ductules are known as the vasa efferentia. And vasa efferentia moves on to the epididymis, and epididymis finally moves into the sperm duct, or which is also known as the vas deferens. So in the duct system, we have the retitestis, we have the vasa efferentia, we have the epididymis, which finally moves into the vas deferens of the sperm duct. So each seminiferous tubule open into the vasa efferentia, and it moves along through the retitestis, as we have seen in the picture. Now here, many vasa efferentia opens into the epididymis, and these vasa efferentia are the main which carry the sperm outside the testis. You can again look into the picture. The vasa efferentia, this is the testis and this is the epididymis. So the vasa efferentia are the tube-like structures which are carrying the sperms and taking out of the testis into the epididymis. So what is epididymis? Now it is another a very highly long convoluted. So we have got this word many a times. So what do you mean by convolutions or convoluted? Convolution or convoluted tube means a tube which has a high number of foldings. So this epididymis is present at the posterior surface of each testis. Now what is the function of the epididymis? Its main function is to temporarily store the immature spermatids. And we have got to know one another character of the immature spermatids, that they are non-motile. As the spermatids active, they mature and forms the spermatozoa. So see, the zoa from the, again coming through the zoo, or the animal having the capability to move. So motile structures are spermatozoa, immature and non-motile structures are the spermatids. So epididymis, what is its function? Its function is to temporarily store the non-motile immature spermatids. And finally, the epididymis loops into and joins with the vas deferens, which is also known as the sperm duct. It forms a loop-like structure, and it over the loop is formed over the urinary bladder in the abdomen, and finally it joins the urethra. You can see over here, this was your testis, this was your epididymis, continue to be the sperm duct or the vas deferens, making a loop over the urinary bladder. This is your urinary bladder. So it is having a loop over the urinary bladder to finally join the urethra. So Moving into the next slide, we will be now discussing about the accessory glands or the secondary sex organs, in which we will be discussing about the three type of glands in males. Now, the accessory glands include two seminal vesicles, one prostate gland and two bulbourethral glands. First of all, from the picture, let us take a look where all these glands are situated. Now, we have, this is your seminal vesicle which joins the urethra. The secretions of the seminal vesicle are released into the vas deferens or urethra or the sperm duct. Just lower to the seminal vesicle, so the seminal vesicles are in pairs. There are two in numbers. Second, we have a single prostate. And finally, we have two little structures over here, one on the either side of the urethra, which is also known as the bulbourethral gland or the Cowper's gland. So now, what is the function of these? All the secretions from the seminal vesicle, the prostate and the bulbourethral gland forms the semen, which has a base for the sperms to swim across. First of all, we take a look into one by one. The seminal vesicle. These secrete mucus and a watery fluid which is very alkaline in nature. And water inside it, it contains a large amount of fructose, which is a disaccharide rather. And this disaccharide, fructose, form of glucose, provides energy to the sperms. Now, the secretions of the seminal vesicle forms around a major portion of the semen, that is around 60 to 70% of the semen consists of the secretion of the seminal vesicle. Moving on to the prostate gland, this is a single seminal vesicle, are in pairs, two in number. Bulbourethral are two in number, but only a single gland is present, that is the prostate gland. This prostate gland surrounds the urethra and produces a milky secretion which forms just about 20% of the semen. This secretion also contains certain enzymes, certain lipids, and especially it contains certain acidic structures that like the citric acid. So what is the function of the prostate? They generally nourishes the sperms, and also the main vital function is they neutralizes the acidity of the vaginal pH. So this happens when the sperms enter into the female reproductive tract during intercourse or copulation. So the sperms, they are actually going through the alkaline, and inside the vagina it has an acidic pH. So this prostate gland's secretion helps to neutralizes the acidity of the vaginal pH, so that the sperms can easily move along the vagina and move to the uterus and finally towards the fallopian tube. Finally, we have the bulbourethral glands. These glands are also commonly known as the Cowper's gland. These are attached to the urethra below the prostate gland. They also secrete mucus and specially helps in the lubrication of the penis during copulation. So now, let us move into the next part of the chapter, that is the female reproductive system. As we have discussed in the male reproductive system, here also we have a primary sex organ, which is a pair of ovaries. We have secondary or accessory sex organs, which plays a helping hand in the female reproductive system. In the accessory ducts, we have a pair of oviducts, we have a uterus, we have a cervix, and finally we have the vagina. Whereas in the accessory glands is concerned, we have one particular set of glands, the Bartholin's or the bulbovestibular gland, which lies one either side of the vaginal opening, or rather the vulva. And another set of glands, which is generally concerned on the secretion of milk, that is the pair of mammary glands. And finally, coming on to the external genitalia, as we had penis in the male, we have the vulva, which actually marks the opening of the vagina. It is the female reproductive system parts. The next slide consists about the primary sex organ, that is the ovary. So, as testis was there, the primary sex organ in the males, we have ovary in the females. First of all, let us have a look where the ovaries are located. Now, as in the picture, we have seen that these ovaries are the structure which lies outside. It is associated with the female reproductive system. It lies outside, which is joined to the female reproductive or the accessory duct through the ovarian ligaments. So, the ovaries are located one on each side of the lower abdomen, and it remain attached to the pelvic wall and uterus by the help of the ovarian ligaments. Now, what is the shape of the ovary? It is generally almond-like, or rather badam ke jaise ye dekhne mein hote hai. It is a flattened body and measuring about 2 to 4 cm in length. What is the function of the ovary? Now here we have two functions. One, the ovary produces the female gametes, that is the ovum or the ova or the egg cell. There are many names to it, which is through oogenesis. And apart from the production of the ova, several steroid hormones, that is, which are also known as the ovarian hormones, are produced. The outer region of the ovary is composed of developing follicles, and the inner side of it is known as the stroma. Now this portion we will be detailing it into the when we will be studying about the structure of the ovary. Nothing is there, it is only the developing follicles on the outer part, the middle which is forming the stroma, and this stroma region actually contains the connective tissue, the blood vessels and the matured follicles, which we'll be studying during oogenesis. So the stroma or the internal or the middle part is divided into two regions, the peripheral outside cortex and the inner medulla. So the accessory duct system, now the ovary releases the ova, which is collected by the fallopian tube. The fallopian tube, also known as the oviduct. There is a pair we have studied earlier. So two small tubes, what is the length of it? Around 10 to 12 centimeter in length, and they lie on either side of the uterus, and it is just near the kidney. The opening of the fallopian tube, actually this fallopian tube or the oviduct has three distinct regions: the infundibulum, the ampulla and the isthmus. So the opening of the fallopian tube is like an inverted funnel, and this funnel shaped is known as infundibulum. The end of the infundibulum, if we see, there is the finger like projections which are called fimbriae. There is a spelling mistake, fimbriae. They move closer to the ovaries at the ovulation to collect the ovum after ovulation. So, when the ova is produced from the ovaries, the fimbriae moves and catches the ova inside it. The ova first of all moves through the infundibulum and then through the ampulla it reaches to the isthmus. So, the infundibulum is the widest part of the oviduct, and here also it is known as the ampulla. This is the widest part of the infundibulum or the oviduct. Next we have the isthmus, and isthmus is the last part of the oviduct, which is a very narrow and it extends into the uterus. So the fallopian tube is divided into infundibulum, a widest ampulla, and the narrowest isthmus, which opens finally into the uterus. Uterus, or rather which is also known as the womb, the mother's womb, because it is the space where the fetus or the embryo develops into finally the fetus and the baby is born. So the uterus is a single, it is hollow structure, and as a pear, what is a pear? Jaisa nashpati hota hai aapka, that is the pear shaped structure. And this uterus is also supported by ligaments, and this is attached to the pelvic wall between the urinary bladder and the rectum. What is the rectum? It is the last part of the large intestine, okay, and urinary bladder. So where is the uterus structure? Uterus presents between the urinary bladder and the rectum. The lower part of the uterus is very narrow and it forms the cervix. The cavity of the cervix, jisko hum log cervical canal or rather birth canal bhi bolte hai, kyunki isi se hi aapka bachcha bahar nikal gaya hai during parturition. Uterus jo hai, they have the wall of the uterus, actually it consists of three layers of tissue, the outer perimetrium, the middle myometrium, and the inner endometrium. Let us have a look. So the outer perimetrium cover, middle is a thick layer of smooth muscles which gives strong muscle contractions during the delivery of the baby. And finally we have the endometrium. It also contains certain kind of glands and many blood vessels. And this endometrium layers undergoes cyclic changes during the menstrual cycle in females. So this is your accessory duct system. We had gone through the fallopian tube or the oviduct. After that we discussed the uterus, the cervix, and through the cervical canal. Coming on to the accessory gland system, in females we have the mammary glands. So we have a pair of, the human female has a pair of mammary glands, that is the breasts, which contain glandular tissues and a lot of fatty tissue. This is the deposition of the fats in the fatty tissues. Each glandular tissue gets divided into 15 to 20 mammary lobes, and such that each lobe consists of a group of cells which is also known as the alveoli. See, this is your mammary lobe, and this mammary lobes, the purple colored structure which is shown over here, these are your the alveoli or the mammary alveolus, singular. These alveoli opens into individual mammary tubules, and these mammary tubules join into a small mammary duct. So this is your the mammary duct. So the ovules open up into the mammary tubules, and each mammary tubule opens into the mammary duct. Now several mammary ducts join together to form a mammary ampulla. This region over here, this is called the ampulla, and it is connected with the lactiferous duct. Lacti, that is having connection to the lactogen or secretion of milk. So that is connected to the lactiferous duct just before the nipple, through which the milk is sucked out by the baby, or through which the milk is released. So now, after the mammary glands, we will be moving on to the next glands, that is the Bartholin glands or the bulbovestibular glands. Now as I have discussed, right at the vaginal orifice, there are two small glands which are present, which are known as the Bartholin gland, and there the main thing is that they help in secreting mucus, and as they are very much homologous to the male glands bulbourethral, they also secrete mucus which help to lubricate the penis, and the Bartholin glands help in lubrication of the vagina at the time of mating or copulation and during the childbirth, that is parturition. Now moving on to the next slide, to the main most important part, that is the gametogenesis, first in male termed as spermatogenesis. Now, quickly a run through of the definition. That is the process of spermatogenesis, where the spermatozoa or the sperms are formed from the diploid sperm mother cell or the male mother cell or the spermatogonia. It takes place inside the testes. Now, when this spermatogenesis begins in males, now in class 8 also, we have learnt in the chapter reaching the age of adolescence that there is a time period coming, that is the puberty, and during puberty, which attains at the age of 11 to 13 in males, the process of spermatogenesis begins. So the testis transport, like the, it continues to form the sperms as well as it forms the sex hormone testosterone that controls the secondary sexual characters. Now, how does this process of spermatogenesis take place? This occurs through the following phases. There are four phases to it: the multiplication phase, the growth phase, maturation phase, and finally the differentiation phase. Now, as I've discussed, the spermatogonia will be undergoing meiosis. But here you will be seeing that it is the spermatogonia which firstly multiply through mitosis and forms the primary spermatocytes. So spermatogonia diploid forming primary spermatocytes, which are again diploid. So here mitosis occurs. So in the multiplication phase and growth phase, we will be seeing that first the spermatogonia will be multiplying and increasing in numbers by mitotic division, and in the growth phase we will be seeing that these increasing spermatogonia will form the primary spermatocytes. So the meiotic division begins in the maturation phase, where the primary spermatocytes will one by one undergo meiosis first to produce secondary spermatocyte, that is haploid, and again these secondary spermatocytes will be undergoing the meiosis second to produce the four equal spermatids. Now, we have to remember one thing, that these cell division which is taking place in the meiosis, one cell is dividing equally into two equal daughter cells. So there is an equal distribution of cytoplasm in these two cells. So the primary spermatocyte, that is the diploid, undergoes meiosis 1 to form two equal haploid cells, and these two equal haploid cells are termed as secondary spermatocytes. They are haploid in nature, so they are having only 23 chromosomes. And again, this secondary spermatocyte will be undergoing meiosis second to produce four equal spermatids. So see, this maturation phase is actually the formation of spermatids. But we have learnt earlier that these spermatids are immature, they are non-motile. So now comes the phase that is known as the differentiation phase, where these spermatids will be transformed into the mature motile structure, which is known as the spermatozoa. And this happens by the process of spermiogenesis. So here the sperm cell get attached to the Sertoli cells, it draws the nutrition, and then these spermatozoa will be finally released out from the seminiferous tubule to release hoga retitestis se hote hue vasa efferentia ke andar. Yaad hai, abhi hum log pehle dekhe the pichle slide mein. So these spermatozoas, after deriving their nutrition from the Sertoli cells, they are finally released from the seminiferous tubules by the process of spermiation. So bahut sare terms hai beta yahan par: spermiogenesis, spermatogenesis, spermiation. Turant dekh lete hain, spermatogenesis hoga jiske andar ye sare stages hai. Spermatogenesis, spermatozoa banne ka process from the diploid spermatogonia. But is spermatogenesis ke andar ek chota sa process hota hai, chota sa nahi, bahut hi vital bada process hai, jo ki hum log naam denge spermiogenesis. जहां पर जो स्पर्मेटिड्स बने थे वो स्पर्मेटिड्स आफ्टर डिराइविंग द न्यूट्रिशन वो अपने आप को ट्रांसफॉर्म कर लेते हैं इनटू द मैच्योर स्पर्मेटोजोआ। तो ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन ऑफ द मैच्योर स्पर्मेटोजोआ फ्रॉम द स्पर्मेटिड, इसको बोलेंगे स्पर्मियोजेनेसिस, और फॉर्मेशन ऑफ स्पर्मेटोजोआ फ्रॉम स्पर्मेटोगोनिया, जो पूरा प्रोसेस है उसको हम लोग बोलते हैं स्पर्मेटोजेनेसिस। और उसके बाद फाइनली ये सेमिनिफेरस ट्यूब्यूल से होते हुए जो ये बाहर निकल रहा है स्पर्म्स, इस प्रोसेस को वी से इट स्पर्मिएशन। क्विक लुक हम लोग देख लेते हैं जो इसका स्कीमेटिक डायग्राम दिया हुआ है, और स्टूडेंट्स ये बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट है आपके बोर्ड के लिए। सो एट प्यूबर्टी देखो कहां पर आपके व्हेन टू स्पर्मेटोजेनेसिस विल ऑकर, इट विल ऑकर एट प्यूबर्टी। सो यहां पे क्रोमोसोम नंबर सेल में दिया हुआ है और यहां पे आपके स्टेजेस अलग अलग क्या क्या होगा वो दिया हुआ है। सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल देयर इज द स्पर्मेटोगोनिया, इट फर्स्ट माइटोटिकली डिवाइड्स इनटू, इट इंक्रीजेस इन नंबर्स, और ये सारे के सारे डिप्लॉयड है, और उसको हम लोग स्ट्रक्चर को बोलते हैं प्राइमरी स्पर्मेटोसाइट। नाउ तो यहां से लेके यहां तक आपका जो पहले दो फेजेस हम लोग पढ़े थे, मल्टीप्लीकेशन फेज और ग्रोथ फेज, ये दोनों ही हो रहा है आपका फ्रॉम द स्पर्मेटोगोनिया टू द फॉर्मेशन ऑफ द प्राइमरी स्पर्मेटोसाइट। मैच्योरेशन फेज बिगिंस फ्रॉम द स्पर्मेटोसाइट व्हेन इट एंटर्स इनटू द फर्स्ट मियोटिक डिवीजन। सो पहला मियोटिक डिवीजन करेगा, देखिए एक सेल इक्वल डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन हो रहा है, तो दोनों सेल का ही जो साइज है यहां पर दिखाने के लिए दोनों का ही आपका इक्वल डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन हो रहा है, ठीक है। तो प्राइमरी स्पर्मेटोसाइट्स अंडरगोज मियोसिस वन टू फॉर्म सेकेंडरी मियोसाइट्स स्पर्मेटोसाइट्स, तो दीज आर हैप्लॉइड हैविंग 23 क्रोमोसोम्स ईच। दिस सेकेंडरी स्पर्मेटोसाइट अगेन विल बी मूविंग एंड कंप्लीटिंग द सेकेंड मियोटिक डिवीजन जब ये बनेगा स्पर्मेटिड्स, और स्पर्मेटिड्स जो होगा दिस स्पर्मेटिड्स विल बी अगेन हैविंग इक्वल डिवीजन, और फाइनली दिस स्पर्मेटिड्स डिफरेंशिएशन होके बन जाएगा स्पर्मेटोजोआ। तो ये डिफरेंशिएशन फेज है जिसको हम लोग स्पर्मियोजेनेसिस भी बोलते हैं, एंड फाइनली द स्पर्मेटोजोआ विल बी रिलीजिंग आउट बाय द प्रोसेस ऑफ स्पर्मिएशन फ्रॉम द सेमिनिफेरस ट्यूब्यूल्स। थैंक यू। Moving on to the next slide, we will be discussing about the hormonal control of spermatogenesis. Here we will be looking into how the hormones play a very vital role in the process of spermatogenesis. Now starting with the most prominent, that is the pituitary, but here the pituitary is also getting stimulated by the hypothalamus. As the age of puberty arises, the spermatogenesis is initiated. Kaise? By the release of one major hormone, the first hormone that is released by the hypothalamus, that is the gonadotropin releasing hormone. So actually hypothalamus releases the gonadotropin releasing hormone kab? At the time of puberty, and this marks the initiation of the process of spermatogenesis. So as the hypothalamus releases gonadotropin releasing hormone, now these gonadotropin releasing hormone will further stimulate the anterior pituitary. So the gonadotropin releasing hormone stimulates the anterior pituitary, and then it secretes two, the anterior pituitary secretes two hormones. One is your FSH or the follicle stimulating hormone, and the other is LH, that is the luteinizing hormones. So see, gonads ka matlab hi hai aapke sex organs. To gonadotropin hormone jo hai wo actually activate kar raha hai kisko? Testis ko, kyunki spermatogenesis hoga kahan pe? Testis ke andar. But hypothalamus khud nahi pura ja sakta yahan tak, to it is releasing the gonadotropin releasing hormone जो इन फर्दर स्टिम्यूलेट कर रहा है एंटीरियर पिट्यूटरी को, और एंटीरियर पिट्यूटरी से फिर दो हार्मोन रिलीज हो रहा है, एक तो LH और दूसरा FSH। अब दोनों का अलग अलग काम होता है। FSH और द फॉलिकल स्टिम्यूलेटिंग हार्मोन स्टिम्यूलेट करता है द सर्टोलिसल्स, दैट इज इनसाइड द सेमिनिफेरस ट्यूब्यूल्स, और ये प्रोसेस करेगा किसके लिए, टू हेल्प इन द प्रोसेस ऑफ स्पर्मियोजेनेसिस। अब आपको लिंक समझ में आ रहा है, सर्टोली सेल्स का काम क्या था, सर्टोली सेल्स एज नर्स सेल्स दे वर टू प्रोवाइड न्यूट्रिशन टू द डेवलपिंग स्पर्मेटिड्स। जब स्पर्मेटिड्स एक्टिव होगा इनटू स्पर्मेटोजोआ, उसको न्यूट्रिशन प्रोवाइड करने के लिए सर्टोली सेल्स थे, तो उसी प्रोसेस को ही हम लोग स्पर्मियोजेनेसिस बोलते हैं, ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन ऑफ स्पर्मेटिड्स इनटू स्पर्मेटोजोआ। तो FSH हार्मोन जो है वो काम करता है, वो सर्टोली सेल्स को स्टिम्यूलेट करेगा इन द प्रोसेस ऑफ स्पर्मियोजेनेसिस। एंड LH याद रखने के लिए सर, LH L से शुरू हो रहा है, लेडिक सेल्स जिसको इंटरस्टिशियल सेल्स भी हम लोग बोलते थे, दो सेमिनिफेरस टिब्यूल के बीच में जो सेल्स पाए जाते थे इन द इंटरस्टिशियल स्पेस। तो LH हार्मोन जो होगा वो लेडिक सेल्स के ऊपर काम करेगा, और लेडिक सेल्स का काम क्या था, एंड्रोजन सीक्रिएट करना, टेस्टोस्टेरोन सीक्रिएट करना। तो लेडिक सेल्स विल बी फाइनली लीडिंग इनटू द सीक्रिएशन ऑफ टेस्टोस्टेरोन फ्रॉम द टेस्टिस बाय द हेल्प ऑफ द हार्मोन LH और द ल्यूटिनाइजिंग हार्मोन। So the Leydig cells start secreting the androgen, that is the testosterone, and which stimulates the spermatogenesis. So तुरंत एक बार देख लेते हैं, hypothalamus सबसे पहले gonadotropin releasing hormone release करेगा, जो initiate करेगा spermatogenesis कब, at the age of puberty. जैसे ही gonadotropin releasing hormone release होगा, ये release hormone stimulate करेगा anterior pituitary को for secreting the two hormones LH and the FSH. ये दोनों ही जो gonads है, male gonads, the testis, वहां पर जाके testis के अंदर तो Sertoli cells है, और आपके Sertoli cells seminiferous tubule के बाहर रहता है Leydig cells, तो anterior pituitary से जो दो hormones है, FSH काम करेगा Sertoli cells के ऊपर और initiate करेगा, help करेगा for the process of spermiogenesis to occur. Spermiogenesis ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन, अगेन बोल रहा हूं बार बार, ये बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है, स्पर्मियोजेनेसिस जो है वो आपका कन्वर्जन और ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन ऑफ द स्पर्मेटिड्स इनटू मैच्योर स्पर्मेटोजोआ। और आपका जो LH या ल्यूटिनाइजिंग हार्मोन है वो काम करता है लेडिक सेल्स के ऊपर, और इट हेल्प्स इन द सीक्रिएशन ऑफ द टेस्टोस्टेरोन। ठीक, तो ये आपका टेस्टोस्टेरोन स्टिम्यूलेट करेगा, और टेस्टोस्टेरोन का काम क्या है, एक तो काम है to the increasing the secondary sexual characters जो puberty से आपका begin हो जाता है, और finally it also stimulates the process of the entire spermatogenesis. तो पूरा reproductive tract stimulates and helps in the spermatogenesis. ये तो हुआ एक तरफी वाला बात। अब आप लोग antagonistic या आपका negative feedback के बारे में पढ़े थे, तो ऐसे negative feedback कौन देगा, ना जो Sertoli cells है सर, ये Sertoli cells आपका एक हार्मोन रिलीज करता है इनहिबिन, और जिसको कभी कभी इनहिबिन भी बोलते हैं। तो देखो, इनहिबिटरी मतलब किसी चीज को रोकना, तो इनहिबिन हार्मोन इज रिलीज्ड बाय द Sertoli cells, जो काम करता है क्या, FSH सीक्रिएशन जो हो रहा था, FSH क्या कर रहा था, Sertoli cells को स्पर्मियोजेनेसिस में हेल्प कर रहा था, तो FSH सीक्रिएशन को सप्रेस करने का काम एक नेगेटिव हार्मोन करेगा जिसका नाम है इनहाइबिन। सो इनहाइबिन हार्मोन जो है, इट इज रिलीज्ड फ्रॉम द Sertoli cells एंड इट विल सप्रेस द FSH सीक्रिएशन। तो जैसे ही FSH सीक्रिएशन कम हो जाएगा, एक नेगेटिव फीडबैक चला जाएगा किसके पास, टू द हाइपोथैलेमस, और तुरंत हाइपोथैलेमस भी जो गोनाडोट्रोपिन रिलीजिंग हार्मोन, LH हार्मोन, FSH हार्मोन, वो साला रोग जो निकलना वो बंद कर देगा। ठीक है, तो तुरंत हार्मोनल कंट्रोल क्या करेगा, जो पॉजिटिव फीडबैक है वो तो आपका गोनाडोट्रोपिन रिलीजिंग हार्मोन टू द एंटीरियर पिट्यूटरी, LH लेडिक सेल्स फॉर सीक्रेटिंग टेस्टोस्टेरॉन, FSH टू द Sertoli cells, Sertoli cells करेगा स्पर्मियोजेनेसिस। ये तो हो गया एक तरफा वाला बात। अब जब बहुत अच्छी तरह सारा स्मूथली चल रहा है, तो FSH का और दरकार नहीं है, तो उस FSH को रोकने के लिए Sertoli cells सीक्रेट करता है इनहिबिन हार्मोन, और वो इनहिबिन हार्मोन तुरंत आपका हाइपोथैलेमस को जाके एक नेगेटिव रिस्पांस देता है, और धीरे धीरे कंट्रोल हो जाता है द रिलीज ऑफ गोनाडोट्रोपिन हार्मोन। तो स्टूडेंट्स हम लोग अभी तक स्पर्मेटोजेनेसिस देख ली अच्छी तरह, कैसे प्रोसेस होता है, कैसे आपका स्पर्म बन रहा है। अब हम लोग डिटेल में पढ़ेंगे वो द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द स्पर्म और द स्पर्मेटोजोन। सबसे पहले देखिए आपके पास ये स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द स्पर्म है एंड दिस स्पर्म कैन बी डिवाइडेड और रेदर इट कंसिस्ट ऑफ फोर पार्ट्स, द हेड, द नेक, द मिडल पीस एंड द लॉन्ग टेल। And the entire structure is enveloped by a plasma membrane. ठीक, तो ये भी एक single cell है, but जिसका structure ऐसे इस तरीके का है। So first of all, dealing with the head, हम लोग यहाँ पे इसके parts पढ़ेंगे और इस parts के क्या-क्या काम हैं, वो भी हम लोग देखेंगे। Starting with the head, so it contains the large haploid nucleus, which is capped. और विच इज कवर्ड बाई द एक्रोसोम। सो ये जो हेड है, इस हेड के अंदर मोस्ट ऑफ द रीजन इज कंटेनिंग द लार्ज हैप्लॉइड न्यूक्लियस एंड दिस न्यूक्लियस विच कंटेन्स द क्रोमोसोमल मेटीरियल। जब फर्टिलाइजेशन होता है, वन पार्ट लाइक द स्पर्म मीटिंग विद द ओवम एंड द जाइगोट, सो द 50% ऑफ द मेल कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स जो ट्रांसमिट होता है इनटू द जाइगोट वो इसी न्यूक्लियस के बदौलत है। दिस न्यूक्लियस इन द स्पर्म इज हेल्पिंग फॉर द ट्रांसमिशन ऑफ 50% कैरेक्टर्स ऑफ द मेल। सो द एक्रोसोम, अब इस एक्रोसोम के अंदर क्या है, दिस एक्रोसोम कंटेन्स हाइड्रोलाइटिक एंजाइम्स। लाइटिक कम्स फ्रॉम द वर्ड लाइसिस, मतलब ब्रेकडाउन। सो ब्रेकडाउन ऑफ हाइड्रोलाइक एंजाइम्स जो कहां पर होगा, आउटसाइड द ओवम होगा। जब ये स्पर्म ओवम के साथ मीट करेगा तो ये ओवा अकेला नहीं होगा, ये ओवा को प्रोटेक्ट करेगा उसके कई सारे मेम्ब्रेन्स। तो उस मेम्ब्रेन्स को डिसॉल्व करने के लिए आपका मेन जो काम करेगा दैट इज द एक्रोसोम। सो इट एक्रोसोम के अंदर जो हाइड्रोलाइटिक एंजाइम्स है दे हेल्प इन डिसॉल्विंग द मेम्ब्रेन्स ऑफ द ओवम ड्यूरिंग फर्टिलाइजेशन। कमिंग टू द नेक्स्ट पोर्शन, अ वेरी स्मॉल रैदर पोर्शन दैट इज द नेक। इस नेक पोर्शन के अंदर आपका सेंट्रियोल्स रहता है। आप लोग सेल डिविजन पढ़ के आए हैं इन क्लास 11th। सेंट्रियोल्स का काम क्या है, एनिमल सेल्स के अंदर सेल डिविजन में मदद करता है। जो स्पिंडल फॉर्मेशन होता है वो हेल्प करता है किससे, द सेंट्रियोल्स विच आर द फ्रॉम द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ सेंट्रोसोम। सो इट कंटेन्स टू काइंड ऑफ सेंट्रियोल्स, एक प्रॉक्सिमल और एक डिस्टल। प्रॉक्सिमल जो सेंट्रियोल होता है वो बहुत ही काम करेगा आफ्टर फर्टिलाइजेशन। जब ये स्पर्म विल बी फर्टिलाइजिंग इनटू एन ओवम एंड विल बी कन्वर्टिंग इट इनटू अ जाइगोट। अब जाइगोट सिंगल सेल है, उस सिंगल सेल जाइगोट के अंदर जब डिवीजन होगा और वो डिवीजन होके एक सेल से दो सेल बनेगा, उस डिवीजन में मेन मदद करेगा आपका दिस प्रॉक्सिमल सेंट्रियोल विच इज इन द नेक रीजन ऑफ स्पर्मेटोसोम। सो इट कंटेन्स द प्रॉक्सिमल सेंट्रियोल फॉर द फर्स्ट क्लीवेज डिवीजन ऑफ द जाइगोट, और जो डिस्टल नीचे की तरफ जो सेंट्रियोल होगा दैट विल बी कनेक्टेड टू द टेल फिलामेंट। कमिंग बैक, जो मेन रीजन होगा एम फॉर मेन एंड एम फॉर द मिडिल पीस। व्हाई? बिकॉज दिस मिडिल पीस कंटेन्स अ प्लेंटी नंबर ऑफ माइटोकॉन्ड्रिया। स्टूडेंट्स आपको पता है माइटोकॉन्ड्रिया का मेन काम क्या है, दे आर द पावर हाउस ऑफ द सेल, मतलब रिलेटेड टू एनर्जी। तो इस स्पर्म्स को एनर्जी प्रोवाइड करेगा ताकि आफ्टर इंसेमिनेशन दी स्पर्म्स हैज टू मूव राइट थ्रू द एक्सेसरी डक्ट्स। आपको याद है अभी हमने लोग डिस्कस करके आए हैं एक्सेसरी डक्ट्स क्या क्या है। इट विल बी रिलीज्ड इनटू द वजाइना, इट विल बी मूविंग आउट टू द यूटेरस, टू द फलोपियन ट्यूब, और वहां पर जाके इट विल मीट द ओवम एंड फर्टिलाइजेशन विल ऑकर। तो ये जो लंबा जर्नी, इस जर्नी को तय करने के लिए उसको एनर्जी चाहिए होगी, और वो एनर्जी प्रोवाइड करेगा जो बहुत सारे माइटोकॉन्ड्रिया प्रेजेंट होता है कहां पर, इन द मिडिल पीस ऑफ द स्पर्मेटोसोम। सो दे आर द एनर्जी सोर्स फॉर स्विमिंग ऑफ द स्पर्म्स थ्रू द ट्रैक। एंड फाइनली वी विल बी हैविंग द टेल, और इस टेल के अंदर एक्सियल फिलामेंट्स होगा। ये एक्सियल फिलामेंट्स दोस्तों आप लोग सुने हो इन द फ्लैजेला एंड द सीलिया लाइक स्ट्रक्चर इन सेल थ्योरी। जब सेल पढ़े थे हम लोग तब एक्सियल फिलामेंट्स के बात किया गया था कि कैसे करके आपका एक सेल सरफेस के ऊपर से आपके उसके जो अपेंडेजेस द सीलिया द फ्लैजेला वो लग के रहता है. सो ये जो टेल है इट कंसिस्ट ऑफ एक्सियल फिलामेंट्स व्हिच इज सराउंडेड बाय द प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन. और ये टेल का काम क्या होगा? ऑब्वियसली इट इज अ स्पर्मेटोजोआ. तो इस जोआ को मूवमेंट देगा टू द स्विमिंग थ्रू द फ्लूइड मीडियम ऑफ द सीमेन दैट विल बी हेल्पिंग बाय द टेल. सो लास्ट कंक्लूड करने के लिए हम लोग ये बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है कि अभी हम लोग पढ़े थे कि सीमेन की जो आपके एक्सेसरी ग्लैंड थे मेल के द सेमिनल वेसिकल द प्रोस्टेट ग्लैंड एंड द बल्बो यूरेथ्रल ग्लैंड. सो वो जो सीक्रिएशंस पैदा करता है और साथ साथ उसके अंदर आपके जो स्पर्मेटोजोआ होते हैं उन सबको मिला के हम लोग नाम देते हैं उसको सीमेन. द सेमिनल प्लाज्मा अलॉन्ग विद द स्पर्म्स इनसाइड इट कंस्टिट्यूट द सीमेन. तो जब इजैक्युलेशन होता है, मेन इजैक्युलेशन जब होता है तो अराउंड रफली 200 टू 300 मिलियन स्पर्म्स आर रिलीज्ड ड्यूरिंग वन इजैक्युलेशन. बट द फैक्ट इज दैट आउट ऑफ दिस 200 टू 300 मिलियन स्पर्म्स इट इज ओनली वन सिंगल स्पर्म द फिटेस्ट ऑफ ऑल द स्पर्म्स विच विल मूविंग थ्रू द ट्रैक एंड विल बी fertilizing the ovum. So the zygote which will be produced, hopefully it will also be the fittest. Because a number of sperms goes waste or it goes dies out, therefore the male also has to release quite a large number of male gametes to compensate the loss and to ensure the fertilization. So we have concluded the spermatogenesis. We have gone through the parts, the different parts of the human reproductive system in males and in females. So we will be proceeding further with the oogenesis in our next class. Till then, if you have liked this video and the presentation, if it is helpful to you, then please kindly like, subscribe and share my channel. Thank you.